The marine environment is teeming with life that supports human economies, livelihoods, and cultures. In the Caribbean, many coastal communities thrive and depend on various resources that are contained within these waters. For an increasing number of humans, the technological advancement of human civilization and the resulting physical developments have put a strain on our natural marine resources. Commercial fish catches are declining. Wetlands are being replaced, and our coral reefs are slowly being destroyed. In an effort to curb this wanton destruction and overuse, humans have created restricted areas in the coastal and marine environments, commonly called marine protected areas.
Marine protected areas refer to areas of the coast or submarine areas that normally reserved by law and usually for the protection of flora or fauna or historical or cultural features. In the Caribbean, marine protected areas are normally referred to as marine reserves or marine managed areas or even marine parks. In Tobago, a fine example of a marine protected area is right here, the famous Buca Reef.
MPAs conserve flora and fauna and associated ecosystems. They protect critical spawning and nursery habitats, protect settlements and growth areas from marine species and spillover benefits to adjacent areas. They also act as focal points for educating the public about marine ecosystems and human impacts on them. They facilitate nature-based recreation and tourism. They also provide undisturbed control or reference sites that serve as baselines for scientific research and for designing and evaluating other areas.
The then government of Barbados wanted to establish an area on the West Coast that was controlled, that they set up a specific area that was a conservation area for your fish stock, protection for your marine ecosystems, your coral reefs, your fringing reefs, and so on. In addition to that, they wanted to establish an area for research and education purposes, and to have recreation and water sports done in a controlled fashion. As a result of that thinking, what the government did then was to establish the reserve using zonation as the principal means of management. Mm-hmm. So you will find that the reserve is divided into four specific zones. Mm-hmm. One deals with scientific research and education. There are two that handle the water sports, things like your snorkeling and your swimming and other water activities. And then there's one that is strictly for recreational purposes, snorkeling and swimming.
The purpose of the marine protected area was firstly to help protect marine biodiversity in the area. Secondly, to help reduce some of the sort of user conflict you had in the area. And by doing so, you also promote sustainable use of the marine resources, which in turn would help with things like preserving food security and so, and in turn, livelihoods, because a lot of persons who use the area, their livelihood depends on it to some extent. For instance, the scuba diving industries and so, as well as some of the fishermen in the area. So put all of these together, we thought there was a need for actually putting some sort of management in place of the area.
Managing an MPA requires a diverse team of dedicated persons to carry out the many functions and duties that go into operating an MPA.
Presently, we have about 14 persons on staff. We have a manager, we have a consultant, we have a project coordinator, an assistant project coordinator, we have an accountant, we have an admin, we have a receptionist, and we have several rangers as well that work in the park full time.
But at present, there are seven rangers. There are six male rangers and one female. We take care of the day-to-day operations in the park. Patrols, fees collection, We also do a level of cleaning in the park.
How are you this morning?
Fine, and you?
Fine, thank you. Are you with us?
Yeah.
Yeah, we are the park rangers. We are checking for the entry fees.
We already paid the entry fees.
In that way?
Yeah.
Okay, then you will give us a receipt. And there is an additional cost of 45 for the mooring.
Okay.
It's a nice place. So, 10, 5, 6, 7.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.
We leave here at 8:30 in the morning, and it takes us at least 15 to 20 minutes to reach in the actual park itself. We make sure that the boats are anchored in the appropriate positions in order that they don't damage the reef.
Patrolling of the Marine Reserve ensure that no one is fishing, spear fishing, no dropping of anchor. We assist the lifeguards with any emergency, collect specimens for the aquarium. Also, we do the maintenance and installation of the moorings and the buoyed areas.
Everything there looks secure.
We've been very fortunate in that most of the guys know us already. And along this whole course, you will find that relationship with the guys actually coming together, knowing each other. So if a guy does anything, chances are we know about it 10, 20 minutes after. So it's a good relationship right now. Even with the catamarans and stuff like that, if they want something, do that. We can do it immediately. We try to help them out any way possible. And if we need a little bit of assistance, it works both ways.
Because we're neighbours, we like to help each other out. And sometimes when we're deploying moorings or if we've got any lifting to do, anything like that, we get help from the Folkestone Marine Park crew and vice versa. If they need a platform to dive from to put marker buoys down or swimming areas for the protected area outside here, right. We kind of work together on a relationship basis, you know. It's not an official relationship, but it's something that has been built up over the years, and we find it's really good to work together.
On board, we have the police, the CEC, we have the museum, we have the Port Authority, we have the government, we have the tourist board, and some other entities. We have the Water Taxi Associations. Okay. So it's yes. So we have a fairly broad spectrum. Okay. And we have some people on the ground in at Lester and Paradise Beach, directly across from the MPA, because we think this is extremely important.
Managing any resource or space with multiple users is not without its challenges, and MPAs are no exception.
One of the major offences that we have been encountered in over time is fishermen going into the park and doing illegal fishing. Recently we had an incident where four fishermen was caught in the park with approximately 100 pounds of fish.
What we could do, we could guarantee we will never go back in Keys and them place. And if we have to be in catch around there, we could sign a ladder. Emergency sentence or something. But to tell you the truth right now, Glenn, right? We don't, we're real done with. We can't really back for yourself now. Right now, if it's anything like a trouble for jail, is jail.
We have to set an example when offences are committed, because we are very serious about conserving and protecting the marine environment. And we arrested them, bring them to Union Island, and we have had charges laid against them.
A key emphasis, I believe, must be to inform people, get on board, go on the ground. We don't expect them to come to us. We must go to them. We must go to them and get their views.
Well, I've been a lobster and spear fisherman for 20 years. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I've seen the difference that you really make in protecting the area, because it's the Grenadines, so we used to fish Tobago Keys, which is now a protected area. Yeah. And I mean, I see in the last 4 to 5 years, the difference in the size of the fish, the difference in the amount of schools of fish, the difference in the size.
Where are you seeing that difference? Inside the park?
Inside and outside the park area.
Okay.
Because I mean, so the area is kind of restricted. Even turtles, you could now play with them. Before, we couldn't play with them. We see them everywhere, but now they get really calm, really tame. You could play with them, you could pet them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it really make a difference. Some things worth protecting.
MPAs within the Southeastern Caribbean, although some were created over 30 years ago, are all relatively young within their management regimes. Yet, their reason for being is more pertinent and critical now than ever before.
Without the park, we wouldn't have much foreigners coming here because the park is what really brings most of the tourists in the Grenadines, really. Because everybody wants to go to Tobago Keys. Everybody wants to go snorkeling, you know. Everybody wants to go and see the turtles. And also the friendly acceptance from the people that dwell in that area, the locals. That is a big significance in encouraging the people to be coming here all the time. So like that, they can spend money in all the different business places, not only with us, but with the restaurants and the supermarkets and, you know, the transports online and all that.
MPAs, how we view it, is one tool that can be utilized in terms of assisting us with the management of our fisheries. As we all know that based on the fisheries, that the ecosystem is very, very important. When I say the ecosystem, I'm talking about mangroves and coral reefs and grass, seagrass beds and things of the sort. They are very, very essential for habitat and for food and for reproduction of our marine species. And as a result, if they are not intact, okay, we can actually lose our fisheries. So we have to ensure that our marine biodiversity is intact. And that's the reason why we have to ensure that we have an MPA program that can protect some of these marine habitats and also maintain our biodiversity.